in 2019, we lost Three Mile Island Unit 1. Why that reactor? Because as opposed to most other nuclear plants in the area, it was only a single unit plant. The other one melted down in 1979. So we had a one unit plant whose costs were higher than the two unit plants of the area and were higher than the almost dirt free, nearly free natural gas going into natural gas plants nearby.
Welcome back to Decouple. Today I have a very special guest, and I'm not referring to Mark Nelson, who all of my listeners no doubt know by now. But just out of frame, we've got Mark Nelson's son joining us. I don't actually know his name yet. Here he is.
Thomas.
All right. So a warm welcome to you both. Mark, you probably only have about 15 minutes before your baby has some pressing need or other, which he will make known. We have some exciting news to get through today. So let's do our best to process that. In short, Constellation has signed a 20-year power purchase agreement with Microsoft, which will see Three Mile Island, Unit 1, not the melted Unit 2, restarted just 5 years after it was shut down for economic reasons. Mark, what's going on? Break this down for us.
First of all, I don't differentiate between Unit 1 and Unit 2. It's all Three Mile Island coming back. I think that people use the meltdowns in the past to smear all of nuclear. So I just say Three Mile Island is coming back. Chernobyl operated for 14 more years. Probably no hope for Fukushima Daiichi. But Three Mile Island rides again. So Three Mile Island has already had a 40 unit one, has already had a 40 year life. It's been shut down since 2019 for two big reasons. Fracking boom made an enormous amount of cheap gas, including under Pennsylvania itself. So there's gas coming out of the ground in Ohio and Pennsylvania, meaning if you set up a new competing natural gas plant, you could drive down the local cost of electricity wholesale prices enough to kill off the local nuclear plant. So that was the idea. Economists said we'd have these markets to destroy long-lived, cheap assets because that will somehow be better for consumers. They have PhDs, so they're very smart, Chris. Anyway, so we lost in 2019, we lost Three Mile Island Unit 1. Why that reactor? Because as opposed to most other nuclear plants in the area, it was only a single unit plant. The other one melted down in 1979. So we had a one-unit plant whose costs were higher than the two-unit plants of the area and were higher than the almost dirt-free, nearly free natural gas going into natural gas plants nearby. And the natural gas plants can turn off when there's low prices, but nuclear plants do best when they're baseload and run for the whole system all the time because they have fixed costs. So in 2019, the nuclear plant was about to go offline and they said to the state, we need subsidies or you're going to lose us. And the state said, not our problem. And then they said to the tech companies, you need to buy our power or you're going to lose this power and you're not going to have it in the future. And the tech company says, oh no, we're already 100% renewables powered. Now, it was a lie. Like they knew they were lying. They knew it was false. They knew they were not getting 100% renewables. They knew they were running off of fossil fuels, but legally they were able to claim, and their lawyers said it was okay to claim that they're on 100% renewables. They did that by building wind and solar in a different state, crediting themselves with that generation, then building their data centers by the coal, gas, nuclear, and hydro plants. Great system until you run out of other people's baseload power, the certificates of which you're not buying. This is what happened. The big tech companies over the last 24 months suddenly realized they needed to 10x the size of their biggest data centers to effectively compete for the cheapest compute, the cheapest operation of the most number of processors. So suddenly they need a gigawatt or more at a time of power to build the largest and therefore the cheapest per unit of computation data centers. But they've absorbed almost all the excess available in the market, and they can't just snap their fingers and bring through existing transmission lines another gigawatt of power. And they certainly can't gather up from renewables here, renewables there, and flow it all to a single point in space, like a single data center, and know for a fact they're going to be able to deliver all that power at a price anywhere close to what the power purchase agreements were for the wind and solar that's getting built. So if we see with levelized cost of electricity or power purchase agreements that are for wind and solar, where they can put their stuff on the grid at $30 a megawatt hour, $40 a megawatt hour. That means nothing to the data centers that need physical power delivery at a specific location. And if they say to the wind and solar, hey, we'll pay 100. Isn't that better than your 30 and 40? And then the renewables would say, so yes, but you're going to have somebody else get it to you. And you're going to have somebody else like have to actually supply the power, because we're just the certificate saying you're totally good, man. So there's the background with my anger. You can hear my anger here, because we lost nuclear plants because of this awful system. In the case of Three Mile Island, clearly Constellation was hedging a little, and they took a sort of German pace of years long, slow disassembly, if that. Now, they shut off that plant when it did need some life extension upgrades and some work. They couldn't justify spending what at the time would have been a couple hundred million on that work. And at the moment, what we're hearing now is that it's about $1.6 billion of spending needed at that nuclear plant to upgrade it for long life. Now, whether that's like to build the data centers, to build the hookups, or to upgrade, or there may be a bunch of goodies thrown in there, but Constellation needed to be sure it could make $1.6 billion and the cost of the power and a healthy profit. I think they've probably been quite certain for some time they could get it. The question was, how much could they get and how much certainty? Now, I would imagine that Microsoft said to anybody in the country that makes power, we'll take 20 gigawatts yesterday if you've got it. Clean, hopefully, but whatever. We're not picky. That's what all the big tech companies are saying at the moment. In the case of Three Mile Island, they would have needed that as soon as possible. And I would imagine that there was a very nice premium that was likely paid to get that restart date as soon as possible and to lock in as much of the power as possible. Now, this is not true behind the meter. This isn't behind the meter. They're going to put this power on the grid. So it's not clear how much of this power is going to a co-located data center versus just being sold into the grid and allowing Microsoft to say they have additionality. What is additionality? It means you're adding low carbon generation. So there's only a few nuclear plants in the country where you can get this additionality by either, you know, turning the back on, or in aggregate, you can have a few nuclear plants worth of uprates if people really push that. So here in Three Mile Island, there's almost none of these left plants to turn back on. We've got what? Dwayne Arnold in Iowa and Palisades in Michigan, but that power has been spoken for probably at lower than the prices that the tech companies would now purchase it. So Three Mile Island seems to be getting a deal that may be the largest electricity deal in US history, or at least one of the largest, certainly from a single power plant. What we're hearing is it's above $100 a megawatt hour, which means on an annual basis, almost $800 million of revenue, not of profit. You know, they've got to pay for the fuel and the staffing and safety and stuff like that at Three Mile Island. They've got to pay for the upgrades too. But they're going to make a few hundred million dollars of profit per year, as far as I can tell, if deal terms hold. And they're going to make it over 20 years. Here's the key point for your listeners, Chris. These are scales of revenue equivalent to the task of financing and building new gigawatt scale nuclear plants in America starting today, if we can deliver reliably. That's the thing. It's not even delivering it cheap, Chris. It's knowing that in 6 years or 7 years, you can be giving Microsoft power at a given location and at a price that they're willing to pay. Three Mile Island is such a high price, in part because it can be available by 2028, and there's almost nothing left that's additionality. Now, are these companies going to wait for additionality? Oh, hell no. They are going to buy up entire nuclear plants. And the cities that are currently using that power are going to suddenly learn the downsides of the electricity markets if they didn't know them before, which is, even though a nuclear plant can keep running for 20, 30, 40 years after it's paid off its construction costs, and even though those operation costs for the nuclear plants may be $20, $25 a megawatt hour, if there's a shortage, you can sell that power for $100, $120, even the plants that were built out of ratepayers' pockets back in the 70s. I'm so happy for the nuclear plants to be making extreme bank. It feels like vindication of what we've been saying for so many years. However, as you can hear my baby crying, he is also worried about what's going to happen to our power bills here in Chicago, where we are almost 100% nuclear.
Well played, Mark. Well played. I mean, it's extraordinary. You and I have been in this, in the trenches for a while in these battles, and we've really moved through a number of phases from, well, phase outs to saving plants, unfortunately not saving all of them, and now into these restarts, and who knows? Looks like new build on the horizon, as you're saying, with the potential economics being suggested by these PPAs. Just shortly, a couple, I guess, closing questions. How does this PPA compare to competitive low carbon power from other sources? Let's say some of the offshore wind being offered in offshore of New England, for instance.
Well, the offshore wind doesn't solve the particular problem that's being paid for in this Three Mile Island PPA, which is guaranteed power. 94% is the expected outcome here, because that's what Constellation aims for in their fleet, 94-95%, right? It isn't guaranteed power over key load periods for the grid, and it isn't going to be guaranteed power at a specific location, right? So the offshore wind, they're looking at $140, $150, $160 per megawatt hour without it providing the certainty that you can provide the power. That's somebody else's problem. So if you bring in a few gigawatts of offshore wind, averaging a gigawatt like this nuclear plant, you can't build the data center unless you can get all of the power demand for that data center coming from the beach side to the data center, not just from the ocean side to the data center, which would mean that on top of starting at a higher cost than these nuclear plants are going to be able to provide you power for, on top of that higher cost, you're now having to actually go out and buy power, which you would think that would be the point of buying a really expensive wind power contract, that takes care of your power. Nuh-uh. That is the start of figuring out where your power is.
I mean, it's just extraordinary as well. You know, the tech companies initially buying renewable energy credits, staying away from nuclear, then starting to entertain the idea of powering with nuclear, but only advanced nuclear. And at this point, again, purchasing power from a power plant that, you know, there's some psychological hangups around in terms of branding. So just, I mean, such an incredible transformation in terms of social and political license that we're seeing developing across the West. What do you think? What do you think next, Mark? You've been hinting at the idea that this might enable new build.
Well,
how realistic is that? What are the time horizons like for that?
Okay. Well, you know, down here in America, we like the AP1000 and related types of technology. If we get started today, as in shovels in by the end of 2025. Sign the deals and start digging, okay? We would be aiming for a controlled rush towards, 7 years, maybe. And then ideally, if you prorate the number of reactors you get over the build period, we would hope that in 10 years, we could get 2 or even 4 out of that site, right? Or over multiple sites, that if you started tomorrow, even though your first power would only be in, say, 6, 7, or 8 years, by years 11, 12, 13, you could have an enormous amount of power. So this is the idea that nuclear, it's shocking how little you can get done with nuclear in a year. It's incredible what you can get done with nuclear over a decade.
And just finally, Mark, there's a number of half-finished plants littered across the USA. Do these represent low-hanging fruits, or is it just too complicated to bring some of these sites back? I remember looking at some photos of summer, and a lot of it's exposed to the elements. Went fairly far along in terms of some of the core modules. What are your thoughts in terms of the idea, say, of getting going on summer again? Is that lower hanging fruit, or do we need to start from scratch with new builds?
Summer's definitely lower hanging fruit. Fortunately, we don't have to guess here, Chris. We the national labs and several private sources have been putting out lists of, ranked lists of what nuclear sites they think should host nuclear first. So the large scale reactors first. Because most of America's nuclear plants were sized for more reactors than ever got completed, that means you've got the waterways, often the transmission corridors and the roadways and railways, the things you would need to add in like short run. There you go. The last time we thought we had a nuclear renaissance in the, into the Bush years before we discovered all the fracking gas and before Fukushima Daiichi and before we started building without having finished designs. Before all that, we had a bunch of plants get their licenses to add gigawatt scale units, often a pair of new reactors, anything from the 1500 megawatts of the ESBWR to the 1200 of the AP1000. So first steps would be looking at all the sites that either had AP1000 construction that stopped. So that's just one, that's summer, or licenses for the AP1000. I'm saying that just because that seems to have been a priority for Westinghouse, but ESBWR and ABWR has not really been the priority for GE Hitachi. Of course, the Koreans would like to sell APR1400 pending working out agreements with Westinghouse. So those are the big three families of designs that you'd look at to be added on the sites that literally permitted those designs and in some cases maintain those active permits to start building those pairs of units. It means the studies are done, permissions are granted. It would be much easier to switch from, say, ESBWR over to AP1000 than it would be to go from scratch. The next step would be the nuclear plants that started building a long time ago and didn't complete. It means they think they had the water supply and the transmission and the space to add nuclear. Those are going to be your top candidates too. In a few cases, we had new nuclear plants ready to be built, like new locations. That's definitely going to be good because you're starting with a blank slate in terms of the site, even if you have all the permissions and studies done. That would be up there. And then finally, new sites that hosted other types of power plants like coal, but never nuclear. And then finally, total blank slate, brand new sites. That would be next. Where the key constraints, again, are transmission, water, and then transit links.
Okay, Mark, I think we'll leave it there. Young Thomas has been extraordinary. Testament to having a great baby and a great father there to soothe him as he coos and cries.
Appreciate that.
Big congrats, Mark, on your biggest accomplishment and making his debut at such a young age on Decouple. I'm sure he'll follow in his father's footsteps.
Thanks, Chris. I'm sure you'll see him again.
All the best.